pretty okay, but is this okay? Like, can y'all hear me?
Yes.
Okay, cool. Y'all, this is so exciting. I'm so pumped to be here and just to see so many sweet faces in a room, just kind of gathered under the same passion for helping sweet kiddos going through some pretty tough stuff is just really exciting. I know both of your philanthropies are just really tied to our mission and what we do, so I'm really excited to just be here and get to serve with you all tonight. I thought it would be helpful for you guys to know kind of the background and where we've been and how we got to everything that you see tonight and how our story kind of came to be. So I wanted to share that with you for just a few minutes. It looks like everybody already has their supplies, so we're good to go to get started when we finish that, so that will be awesome. So just to share a little bit about our story and about me, my name is Rebecca Dotson. I am an alum of UT. I went here, graduated in 2013 in kinesiology, and really the whole season that kind of led me to all of this was right after I was really in the same season of life as you. So I love talking to college girls because I just love that time in my life, and really it all started after graduation, so like the day you're all waiting for, right? So I graduated in May and had been interning for a company. I see some like shaking, like we're not ready to graduate at all. So I graduated in May and I had been interning for a company for quite some time, and they offered me my first big girl job. I was blessed enough to get to stay in the Knoxville area after graduation. And so I was really, really pumped about that. Really fun season of my life. I had a great just community of friends here in Knoxville. And so, like, teeing it up, it's like mountaintop season, right? And so that fall in September was really where our journey began. So there came a weekend, and my parents had planned to come visit me that weekend. And my dad calls me on that Friday. They were headed this direction. And, you know, when one of your people, whether it's your sibling or your parent, or your best friend calls you and there's just like, there's something not there. There's something just different in their voice and you don't really know kind of what's going on. That was the feeling that I got when I talked to my mom and dad on the phone that day. And we hung up, they drove to Knoxville. And I remember this memory like it was yesterday. My parents walked in the front door and we kind of caught up for a minute. And we sat down on our couch, on my couch in my little apartment. I was still living with my best friend from high school at the time. And my parents got kind of quiet, which is odd for them, if you know them. And my sweet dad, I remember it like it was yesterday, just kind of with a broken voice, he said, "Rebecca, I don't really know how to start this conversation at all, but your mom has been diagnosed with breast cancer." And in that moment, and really that whole weekend, I don't remember a lot of conversations. Those 7 or 8 words are really about all I remember, because we didn't know at that point what really the trajectory of the next year and a half or so was going to look like. All I knew and all I heard was the word cancer. And so as you can imagine, that was pretty scary. And so we kind of started walking into what does this season look like? What does treatment look like? What's that going to mean for our family? I'm living here. They live about an hour and a half away. So the next week we kind of found out, okay, so it's going to require surgery and more than likely chemotherapy, we thought at that point. And depending on how all of that shakes out, potentially radiation. All of that did take place, and just to go ahead and let you know the end of the story, my mom has been cancer-free for 2 years, so I'll get there in a minute. Yes. Praise the Lord. So we start kind of walking forward into all of that, and surgery went well. About 2 months later, she started chemotherapy. So kind of big moment number one that I'll tell you about. I have a devotional called She Reads Truth that gets sent to my email every morning. Raise your hand if you've heard of that. Some of you, yeah, a lot of hands in the room. They are a group of ladies based out of Nashville. They're awesome. If you've never checked them out, I always give them a plug when I speak because they're a big part of our story. Got their email sent to me every morning, so when I get to work, even still, I always read their devotional each morning. And so I brought it up that morning, and I read it. And like I said, it was the month of November, and so their topic for the month was Thanksgiving and gratitude. And the title that day happened to be Giving Thanks and Suffering. And I was just so crazy on one of the toughest days of my life and of my mom's life. And so I forwarded it to her, kind of went on about my day. And she calls me at work, which, you know, she doesn't typically do. And she said, Rebecca, I know you're at work. I just had to call you. I found my verse. And I was like, Mom, that's awesome. You know, what do you mean? And she said, so you just forwarded me that thing. And we both read She Reads Truth quite a bit. And she said, were you paying attention to the scripture that was at the top? And I honestly, in that moment of that busy day, I loved the content, but I did not pay attention to the scripture that was at the top of the devotional, and it was Romans 8:18. And she reads it to me, and it says, for I consider that the present sufferings of this life aren't worthy to be compared with the glory that shall be revealed in us. And she said, that's my verse. That's my verse that I'm going to claim for my journey. And, you know, walking through something really tough like cancer, a lot of people came to her with encouragement and scriptures and quotes that had kind of been their thing that they claimed. But she said, you know, in that day, the Lord just sent that her way. It was really an encouragement to her and just became the verse that she claimed. And so I'll get to the name in a minute. You're probably already connecting the dots. And so she goes to chemotherapy that day, and she calls me that night. Again, I'm here in Knoxville. They're an hour and a half away in the Tri-Cities, and so I get home from work, and she's kind of recounting her day, and she tells me, you know, we got there. It's kind of an open space. She's describing, you know, kind of what went down. I don't really know, didn't know what chemotherapy looked like, what that process was like. None of us did. And so she's walking me through her day, and she starts telling me about this lady that she sat across from in chemotherapy. So this is big moment number two. I said number one was the verse. Number two is this moment on the phone with my mom. And she starts describing this lady. She says, you know, she was an elderly lady. She was alone, so she was there when I got there to start treatment, and she was also there when I left. So there for a very long time, 7 or 8 hours, taking treatment, and she had lost her hair. Again, she was sitting alone, and it just broke my heart to think, you know, my dad had taken off work to go with my mom, and so she's recounting that, and I'll take a quick sidebar, and I'll come back to that moment here in a second, but just to give you full context of kind of what got us through this season. Rewinding 15 years of my life ago, at a very, very young age, just really saw my deep need for the Lord and trusted Christ as my Savior when I was 10 years old. And really fast forwarding to that moment and that season of our life without having Jesus to put my hope and my trust and my faith in, I don't know how I could have walked through that season or my parents either. And so back to that moment on the phone, she's walking me through talking about that lady, and I just keep thinking, you know, my dad is amazing, and he is kind of walking her through this whole season, and he took her wig shopping, and she's already got a wig, we're already prepared for when she loses her hair, and I had learned how to crochet and knit from my great-grandmother years and years ago, but I hadn't done it in years, and so I'd started crocheting and knitting and sewing her hats, kind of in anticipation of that pretty tough day. And we had a church family that would send her cards, and she would call me and have gone to the mailbox and say, you know, guess who sent me a card today? Guess how many cards I got sent in the mail today? And that was like the shining moment of every day for her when she didn't have energy, and that was really the most exciting thing that happened that day. But that was really cool for her. So there were a lot of things that encouraged her. So back to that elderly lady that she sat across from, I kept thinking, man, she had a husband that took her week shopping? Does she have church family that are sending her letters in the mail to encourage her or to give her a call? Does she have a daughter that's crocheting her hats and all of that? So I'm wrapped up by thinking that there are people that face things similar to my mom that didn't have that stuff because it was hard enough with it. But then far and above all of that, did she know the Lord? And so we hang up the phone that night, and for her, again, she was kind of recounting, telling me about her day. But for me, it was really the first moment that I felt like the Lord was putting on my heart, like, there's a people group here and a burden I'm putting on your heart, and I want you to do something about it. And so I continued making her hats, and there came a day where, like, she had plenty. And so I went to chemo with her once, and there was this box sitting on a counter, and people had made hats and had donated them probably from church groups and things like that. And that's pretty typical in a chemotherapy type setting. And I thought, I'll just make some and I'll just give them to her treatment center. It was winter time and I enjoyed crocheting. And so I started doing that. And over time, it was like every step I took forward, the Lord just had something so much bigger than what I had planned for all of that. And so I started thinking, do I partner with somebody that's already started a thing? And there are many things out there that incorporate a lot of what we do, but none of it seemed personal enough for me. Going back to that moment where I described all the things that encouraged my mom. And so as I start kind of walking into that, I realize that letters of encouragement and cards and things like that that are very personal really encouraged my mom. And then when I would come home with a new hat that I had crocheted her, it made her day. So those two things just kind of stuck, and I thought, well, if we package those things together and we start a thing, and, you know, what do we call it? And so back to the verse, Romans 8:18, after that day when my mom called me and told me, you know, she felt like she had found her verse, I realized a couple of days later that she was diagnosed on the 18th day of the month of September. Of that year. And so in so many small ways, there were just so many reminders of why, like, it was a good idea to pick that name. And I wanted a name that we would have to explain to people. I often get asked, you know, what does 818 Ministries mean? And I love that there's a special meaning to that. So start walking into all of that, and I launched it in February of 2015. So it's just been our 3-year anniversary a couple of weeks ago. And so in February of that year, we start kind of collecting hats. We've got a website going, and we're going to collect hats, and we're going to donate them. That was about all I had figured out at that point. And another special season was I served at my church with a football player that played here at UT. He found out about kind of what we were doing, and he came to me one day and he said, you know, I love that you're shipping these hats out everywhere, but wouldn't it be really cool if, like, we just visited the hospital and we, like, took them ourselves, and maybe I, like, brought some teammates. And so we did that, and that was really awesome at East Tennessee Children's Hospital. And so then people keep sending me these stories of these girls dressing up like princesses and visiting kids in a hospital, and I thought, okay, that would be cool. That'd be another way to connect with patients. We could go to different hospitals and dress up and hand deliver hats, and that could be a thing. Okay, so we did that at East Tennessee Children's Hospital. And then kind of walking into the next couple of years, we got the opportunity to go to St. Jude 3 or 4 times. So I'm going my 5th time in May, which I'll talk about here in just a minute. And so we started kind of building out what does it look like to make all of that sustainable. And so kind of ways to get involved moving past tonight, you'll have the opportunity to sign up for our email list. It's a great resource where we'll announce volunteer opportunities, where we go into a hospital setting to talk about kind of what that's called. We call that our impact squad. So when you dress up as a princess, a superhero, a Toy Story character, whatever it happens to be that day, and you go with us to a hospital to donate hats and just love on kids, that's what we call our impact squad. Something like tonight is called an impact night or an impact.